Well, good morning, everybody. It's good to see you all here. Welcome to another exciting Grand Rounds. I'm very pleased to introduce our speaker this morning, Dr. George Mejicano. Dr. Mejicano received his MD from the University of Illinois and completed his residency in internal medicine and fellowship in infectious diseases at the University of Wisconsin. He serves as the Senior Associate Dean for Education at OHSU, where he oversees the entire educational portfolio, UME, GME, CME, CPD, and graduate studies for the School of Medicine. He's the leader of OHSU's team working on the AAMC's core EPAs for entering residency pilot, which we'll learn more about today, and is the PI of the joint proposal from the OHSU and UC Davis that was awarded $1.8 million as part of the AMA's Reimagining Residency Strategic Initiative. He also was the PI for OHSU's $1 million grant from the AMA for the original Accelerating Change in Medical Education Initiative. He is a progressive thinker in medical education. We're excited to hear about the projects that he's working on and worked on it up at OHSU to revolutionize the way we train doctors in the future. Welcome, Dr. Mejicano.
Thanks so much. Appreciate that. Can you guys hear me in the back? Yes, excellent. All right. Thanks for the kind invitation. It's great to be back, and I see some familiar faces in the audience. When I was asked to talk about time variable competency-based education, I said, of course, because I'm one of the zealots. So you can all decide whether or not this is the wave of the future or it's utter madness. And that's really what this is about, is to have a dialogue with that. I'm going to try to go through the slides in about 40 minutes, so I'm going to speak pretty quickly, because I think the interaction at the end is going to be more important. I'd love to know hear your thoughts and your reactions to this. So here's a reflection to start, right? If you were to start completely over again, thinking about what you learned in medical school and even in a residency or fellowship versus how you practice and what you think is important in the care of patients, right? What would you do differently? How would you redesign it differently? That was sort of the challenge that I was faced with when I was recruited here from the University of Wisconsin almost 9 years ago. I'm going to try to describe my presentation in four acts. The first two are much longer. The third and fourth one are much shorter. And we're going to start with curriculum transformation. And then I'm going to focus a lot on how we assess learners and arguably maybe how we should assess clinicians in practice. And then talk about some of the challenges we faced and then finally some lessons learned at the very, very end, which will be very quick. Okay, so here's probably I want to start sort of getting into the challenges here. If you look on the left side, arguably this is where we are right now in medical education, in UME, undergraduate medical education, the MD program. The students really, they dive deeply into basic and clinical sciences. They're focused on grades. They're really focused on this, what are called the STEP exams, right? What most of us in the room used to call the NBME, now they're called the USMLE, because they think that's the gateway to get a good residency. And that's what they're trying to do. The residency management system is right now very competitive, they're obsessed with this, right? And arguably, we have a national curriculum based upon STEP exams. In fact, there's this gigantic what's called test prep industry that is really driving a lot of stuff. And a lot of the students say, I don't even need to go to class. I just need to just focus on what these books are, these QBanks quizzes are telling me what I need to learn to do well on the STEP exams. But I think the right side is actually far more important here. We need to blend not just clinical and basic sciences, we're not forgetting those, but we need to bring in health system science, the art and practice of medicine within a system, and really focus on patient-centered skills, because what we're trying to do is produce the best doctor possible, as opposed to make me look shiny so that a residency program director wants to take me on. So when we redesigned the curriculum at OHSU, we were focusing on two things: how to make people residency ready on July 1st, and also what does society actually need. That was our goal through a long process. And we came up with six principles, which are here. We wanted to be learner-centered in the upper left. We wanted to allow customization and individualization at the 9 o'clock position on the left. Down at more about 7:30 or so. Really foster critical thinking, lifelong learning, the spirit of inquiry. Upper right, we wanted to talk about or foster active learning methodology, integrate this health system science. And then on the bottom right, which has gotten a lot of the, quote, the controversy, if you will, as well as some of the attention that we've gotten, is try to uncouple time from education, right? And I'm going to go off on just a little bit of a tangent, just very, very quickly, that the standard unit of student progression, learner progression in higher education is something called the Carnegie unit. Most of you know that as credits, right? I get college credits. Just a very quick side story. The origin of the Carnegie unit was not about how what students have achieved in order to get a degree. It's actually was created for faculty work to create a pension. So what we use to say, oh, I've learned X, it's actually about, oh, how much work I've done to create a pension back in the 1930s, right? It's sort of a crazy system. So can we uncouple time as opposed to credit is a big challenge. So a little bit about the history here. By the way, I'm getting some feedback. Are you guys hearing that too? Yeah. I don't know if we can adjust the mic there. Maybe I should use the podium. Yeah. On the tie here? Let's see if we can do that. Does that work better? Yes? Can you still hear me in the back? Yeah. Okay, great. Okay, so a little bit about sort of the context here. We started in 2012. That's when I was recruited to OHSU. We moved into the new building, the RLSP down by the waterfront. But we also did this. The LCME, which is the Accrediting Agency for Medical Schools, came just before I got here and basically put the school on warning. We had lots and lots of curricular problems. And that actually softened our ability, or allowed us basically to blow up some things, because people were saying, like, everything's fine. Well, the accreditor was saying, no, things are not fine. And then we were fortunate to get involved with a bunch of national projects, which we'll go into a little bit. And this is what eventually we came up with. And the details don't matter here, because basically these integrated blocks in the light gray over here, and then core clerkships. But look at the yellow, green, and purple. The idea here is that we can thread things all the way through the curriculum. And so things like, for example, whether it's evidence-based medicine or public health or even anatomy, you could actually thread all the way through. So as opposed to taking just an anatomy course and then you're done. The way I think about it is this. If you think of like a pearls on a string, from a curriculum perspective, the pearls have always been the most important thing. I take anatomy, I take physiology, I take pharmacology, I do surgery, I do internal medicine. And what we're trying to do here is actually say the threads are more important. The threads are more important than the pearls. And that sort of starts to revolutionize things. And so a lot of things have changed. Active learning, the classroom's looking completely different. They're not like this kind of room, right, with fixed seats. Simulation and active learning play major roles in our processes. And we've, again, incorporated this idea of health system science, this idea of everything from what do drugs cost to how do you get something, should we practice the same way for back pain at Providence? Those kinds of things are part of health system science. And here's a bunch of our innovations, just to give you some example. We actually created an epic sandbox. And so I'll use myself. If I'm, quote, the patient that the students are working on, I get cloned 160 times. There's 160 of me in an epic sandbox. So every student is doing different things to me as a patient, right? Some are getting potassiums and some are getting CBCs and that kind of stuff. And so each student is basically taking care of one George across this epic sandbox. And we start teaching the electronic health record and how to use that kind of technology on the second week of medical school. That's an example. IPE stands for Interprofessional Education. We have a Foundations of Patient Safety and Quality Improvement class that every clinical learner at OHSU has to take. That's public health, nutrition, PA, dental, dentistry, pharmacy. We bring all the learners together to work in teams. That's an important piece. We do a rural community project that's interprofessional. The fourth one's an interesting thing. This was created by Reem Hassan, who's one of our MedPeds docs. She created SNAP. It's basically students as navigators. So we take about 20 of our students, and they actually have to learn how to be a medical assistant, and they're assigned patients, and they actually do home visits and all this stuff like that about how to actually help a patient navigate our complicated healthcare system. Communication skills workshop, we actually have these stations where you actually have to go into a set of actors and tell them that you made a medical error, right? right? And confess to that kind of process. And how do you talk to patients when you've done something that you think is responsible to an adverse outcome? Lots of things around value-based care and cost-conscious care, and these, again, health system science exams. And we were pioneers in creating coaches, that's on your right, and Ready, which is our electronic portfolio. A little bit about coaches. Here's the concept. Even Michael Jordan got better because of Phil Jackson, right? And so in medicine, what is the equivalent of a coach? And how do we use a coach to help us improve? So every one of our students is assigned a coach, and they follow them all the way through, and eventually we want to push that into residency going forward. Now, one of the things I mentioned was we're trying to uncouple time. So in other words, when you're ready, you're ready. Why should you have to wait? And vice versa, if you're not ready, why would we let you go if you're not ready? So here are some concrete examples of how we've uncoupled time. Perhaps our most audacious experiment is with oral surgery. So I don't know if you guys know how this works, but oral surgeons are a dentist first. They get a dental degree first, right? And then they apply to medical school at the same time they're applying to a general surgery internship and an oral surgery residency program, simultaneously, right? So literally on the first day of school, at orientation, the first day of medical school, we give them a ticket to take the step one exam, and then if they pass it, and so far they all have, then we do basically what are called a 10-station OSCE, a clinical skills examination. And so they become third-year clerks, the equivalent of a third-year medical student, 6 weeks after they've started medical school. But remember, they're dentists first. So that's an example of acceleration because of this, they've shown the skills that they can move forward. We can also actually, we've allowed students to skip clerkships if they can, and we do it by two ways. One is by testing. The other way is actually by experience, right? And I'll just give you an example of when I was a medical student a long time ago, one of my classmates was actually a large animal veterinary surgeon. She actually had worked at Brookfield Zoo in Chicago. She had done surgery on tigers and stuff like that, right? So why would we make her do medical school, like everything again, right? But that's how it was. And so the idea here is if the three signatures are the coach, the clerkship director of the specialty, and Tracy Bumstead, who's the associate dean for the MD-MD program. If the student can get those three signatures to say, yes, you have the skills, why repeat pediatric clerkship, or why repeat internal medicine, or why repeat general surgery? You can just zoom along and skip that. That's an example of using time efficiently and effectively as opposed to making people do the same thing. Joyce Hollander Rodriguez down in Klamath Falls, where one of our family medicine residency programs is at, she has this thing called Oregon First, where she actually takes fourth-year students going into rural family medicine and embeds them into the residency program. They start developing a panel where they're going to do their residency, and they spend 9 months in rural Oregon and then transition into the residency program there, as an example. Right? And we allow early graduation. I'm going to talk a lot more about that. So far, in the last 3 years, 120 of our students have graduated, usually 3 months ahead of schedule. So we're creating something called PACE, and we hope Providence is going to be one of our partners in this. This is about 2 years still. We're not implemented this. Have not implemented this yet. But here's the concept: the green bars are preclinical, the blue bars are clinical experiences. So our students generally start doing their clinical experiences in February of the second year. I'll try to show that here with this. So right here, February of the second year is where they start doing clerkships. So the idea here is if you want to apply to this program, you apply in the spring of your second year of medical school. And what you basically say is you commit to a specialty early. You say, I want to be a surgeon. And so you apply, and you go through a vetting process that includes the surgery residency program director. And then if you get accepted, you basically then do rotations so that the surgery residency program can make a decision. And they make a decision on basically January 1st or December 31st of the third year. And then once that commitment is made, as soon as we say you are good enough to get the MD degree, you will become a resident immediately. So you could graduate as early as 2.5 years into medical school if you have the chops to do it. Right? Most of them won't finish that early. Most of them will finish probably sometime in their fourth year. Some might actually go beyond their fourth year, but the residency program has committed to you regardless of when you will graduate, right? And so we're going to do this to about 10% of our intern class, so about 20 students every year. So this whole idea of selecting specialty from the get-go, from the very get-go, as opposed to waiting everything. And now that makes some people very uncomfortable, because some people in this room, I'm sure, think that we should produce what are called pluripotential stem cells, right? I want a medical student that can do anything, right? I could be a pathologist, I could be a urologist, I could be a psychiatrist. Is that really serving society, right? And that's a question, a challenge for all of us to think. Because if you think about engineering, they differentiated age 18. Mechanical engineering is very different than electrical engineering, right? Why is medicine so late? And the doctors of nursing practice programs, right, the DNP programs, you know, nurse practitioner programs, they differentiate as well. So right now at OHSU, we have six DNP programs. So if you're going to be a nurse midwife, it's a very different thing than if you're going to be a nurse anesthetist, for example. So why do we wait for differentiation post-MD as opposed to pre-MD? And that brings up all sorts of things like, what does an MD actually mean in the modern era, right? Really, what does it mean? And as an ophthalmologist, what do they have in common with, a forensic pathologist, right? It's a really interesting concept to think about. One of the questions that I always get is, well, wait a second. What about the match? Don't they all start, all the interns start on July 1st? What do we do with them, right? Well, let me tell you, it's very creative. Here's a bunch of things that happen. One of them is we can start them early, all right? That's challenging financially, but it can be done. But here's a bunch of other things. You can work on, you can do basically enrichment, you can build skills, you can go make some money, you can do boot camps. And what's really interesting is actually Kaiser came to us, Ellen Singer, the third bullet from the bottom, and Ellen said, you know what, we actually have these quality improvement projects that we want in our system. We'll give these early graduating students, if they're not going to get their internship until July 1st, and we'll basically help have them be workhorses in our quality improvement programs or system. And so they get experience doing that, and they get paid $6,000. So it's a sort of a temporary job involved in a different kind of thing. So there's lots of options for them to proceed. So those are some of the curricular things that we've done. Now, what I'm really going to get into is the assessment. So the first thing is something called INCUS, I-N-C-U-S. So I was one of, for better or worse, I was one of about 30 people that were chosen to go to this invitational conference. And INCUS stands for Invitational Conference on USMLE Scoring. So the STEPS exams, right, these exams that the students take, there's four exams that you have to get your license in the United States. The first one is scored numerically. There's a number to it. And now everybody involved with the residency programs here understands that, because you're looking for, oh, how did you score on your step one exam or your step two CK exam? And the question is, does it matter? Does the number matter, and should it be pass-fail? Is there really a difference between a 240 and a 210? Statistically, there is no difference. These are licensing exams, not residency selection exams. And yet, when you ask the residency program directors, what do they look for in allowing who to interview, the number one thing on the far left is the step one score. So we're using basically a flawed instrument to determine who even gets a chance to interview is the issue. But then if you ask the residency program directors across the country, how do you pick your residents in the match list? So in other words, not how do you screen to get an interview, but how do you determine who you really want to be in your residency program? And you can see, right, it's interactions with the faculty and the residents, and it's the interpersonal skills. It's the soft skills, right? When I was in the internal medicine residency program at Wisconsin, right, we used to call this basically the "we don't want jerks" test, right? Right? And everybody knows, I'm sure some of you know this, right, in your heart of hearts, think about some classmates you had, both in GME and in UME, that basically were brilliant, book smart, could pass every exam with ridiculous scores, and yet you would never trust them with your mother, right? So it's a very flawed process. We're trying to blow that up nationally. The idea here is use the right tool for the right job, not a weed whacker for a haircut, right? That's the concept. And so what are these other kinds of things that we could use? So there's a whole bunch of us across the country that are working on these things, and here's some of them, these sim exercises, and I don't know if you've heard of the standard video thing. So emergency medicine did this, that you basically, everybody going to emergency medicine basically did an interview that was standardized, and that was scored by a third party, and that was a score that was sent to the residency program directors in emergency medicine. The students hated it, right? But that's an example of a novel, an innovation. I'm going to focus on the bottom two here because that's about the uncoupling of time. Competency assessment and what's called EPA assessment, and I'll explain what these are. So here's the idea. What we're trying to do is create experts from novices, right? That's really what it is, right? You start down here, right? Someone who, you know, may be really, really smart, but they're a novice. They don't have experience. They don't have the skill set to be a good clinician. And we're trying to drive them to expertise. And in medical school, all we're trying to do is go take a novice to become an advanced beginner. And then GME is where the slope really goes up. That's where you want them to be at least competent to be released out into the public, right? And then everyone knows you keep building skills and experience as you go into practice. So it's a lifelong journey, if you will, from novice to expert. That's the idea. Well, how do we know when someone is at a certain level? And here's the problem in medical education, and maybe higher education writ large. We're really good at a granular assessment. We're really good at this, right? Oh, tell me the drugs that cause pancreatitis, right? Tell me the indications for, you know, carotid endarterectomies. We're really good at testing that kind of stuff, right? Even with skill sets, right? We do these sim things right now with different kinds of surgical techniques, and you can tell we know how to do that kind of assessment, but we don't know the elephant, right? So we're really like that proverb about the blind people around the elephant don't know what the elephant looks like. We just know one single components of it, and that's a major problem in medical education. So what we're trying to do is to say, okay, let's figure this out. Can we look at this more synthetically, in a more holistic manner? So there's this thing called the EPA, the big yellow blob, and I'm going to explain what that means in just a minute, which is a holistic perspective. It's a big, big kind of thing. And within EPAs, there's these different competencies, these different sort of clusters of skills. And in those clusters of skills, you can actually look at milestones. You can think of it as steps along the way, all right? So you can actually judge, how far someone is along the way in a given competency. And we've been really good at that little step part, but we've not been very good at the big yellow blob. And here's the analogy that we use, and it's driving. So think about when someone in your family was 16 years old or about to turn 16, and they were going to get their driver's license, right? So they learned the rules of the road, right? And they may know how to do a three-point turn, how to merge onto the highway, right? Those are the different skills, right? But what I told my daughter, my oldest daughter, before she got her license was, look, I don't care what the state said. I don't care what your scores were. In driver's ed, what I want you to do is go pick up your sister at volleyball, get a gallon of milk. You better be back in 30 minutes, and there better not be a scratch on the car, right? I don't want this, right? We're really good at what's the rules of the road. We're terrible at get your sister from volleyball, right? And that's what we're trying to get at, because ultimately there's a sense of trust. And so what EPA stands for is entrustable professional activities. Activities is basically the work of being a doctor, professional activities. Entrustment means I trust you to do it. So Jesse, if I was working with you in your clinic right now, how would you know whether or not you would trust me with your patient, right? But the same thing is true, by the way, if you're gonna hire a partner. How do you know? I mean, how do you really know? It's an interesting question to think about. So trust has important dimensions that we're just starting to get into in medical education. How do we trust people that, here, take the scalpel, or here, take, you know, write orders, admit a patient, do a procedure, whatever it happens to be. So the big blob that I was talking about, that's the EPA, right? Can the skills of being an OBGYN doc or a ophthalmologist, whatever it happens to be. So how do we do it? So I'm going to get granular just for a few minutes and talk about this stuff. What you're looking here at is one of our dashboards in our portfolio system. This is a real student at OHSU. And what you're looking at here is the competency of professionalism. And professionalism has 11, I should say the domain of professionalism. And professionalism has 11 competencies that are part of it, those components of professionalism. And what we have done is we've said there's three milestones. And we said level one, level two, and level three. But then we just said one more thing. We said not only are we going to have skilled faculty members who have been trained to determine what level they are for each of these competencies, we also said we're not going to take one person's opinion. And this goes back to the thread on the string, right? The pearls on the string. We're going to say, medical knowledge around drugs, right? Just to make a point, pharmacology. So what would the psychiatrist say in a psychiatry clerkship? What would the pediatrician say in the pediatric clerkship? What would the internist say in the internal medicine clerkship around pharmacology, right? That's the concept. And so what you have here is a minimum level of assessors. So this is the number that we have said you have to have this many assessments in order to be good enough. And so what happens is, in this case, for example, for PPP.10, they have 5 level threes, right? But they needed 6, and so they're 83% complete. In contrast, in this one, they've had 5 people say they're good to go. We only needed 3. You get a little green thumb, and that's why it's 100%. So you can quantify progression along milestones across multiple viewing platforms, if you will, to determine, yes, they're good to go. But this is still that granular piece. It's still not the whole elephant. It's the ear of the elephant or the trunk of the elephant. So you can blow it up bigger and say, well, what about the whole domain? So now you have the 6 domains that people are used to if they deal with residents. So you have everything from systems-based practice to medical knowledge to communication skills. And you can do the same quantification. You can see how these students are progressing over time, but still at the granular level. And this is a snapshot, actually, of the whole. Now you're looking at one student across everything they need to get the MD degree at Oregon compared to their class. So this kind of picture tells us several things. The first thing it tells us is that there are what are called curricular holes. So if you look at this, I should probably orient you. The bars, the height of the bars are the progression of one student across all 43 competencies. And the colors of the bars are because there's 6 domains. The little rhomboids, the little black diamonds, those are the class means for at a given time, at one point in time. And so if the bar's above the black diamond, they're, quote, they're doing better than their class at a specific point in time, right? But if you look at the black diamonds, you see that in some cases, nobody in the class has achieved that. So is that a problem of the students or is that a problem of the curriculum, right? Or is it that they actually do it, but we just don't assess it? So this we can use these tools both to assess learning, but also to assess the how the curriculum is designed. And so we've actually made adjustments to address these gigantic holes. But that's still, all I've been talking about here are the milestones and the competencies. Where we're really going with is the whole EPA. And so what we've decided to do is to try to crowdsource this. Now, this gets a little bit complicated and certainly sort of science sci-fi kind of stuff, so just bear with me. What we've done is we've empowered the students to ask anybody who's supervising them, judge me about how I'm doing, but not for the month or for the entire clerkship or for the year, today. So the students actually say, judge me today on whether or not I was able to do that procedure, or judge me today on whether or not I was able to do a case presentation. Not for the whole week, today in clinic or on the wards or wherever, or in the unit, wherever you happen to be. So here's how it works. This is the student part first. Deepthi is one of our, she actually graduated already. She allows me to show this. So this is actually her, right? So here's the student finds herself. She says, which of these skills, these units of work, she's going to be focused on. And in this case, she chose EPA 4, which is writing orders, right? So she's going to write, so how am I doing for writing orders, right? She's doing emergency medicine, and she's in the ED, and she's asked an attending physician to judge her, right? And she asked Anna Nelson, who was at that time one of our faculty members, to do the judgment, and she worked with Anna one time. So this is, the student loads all this in, and then the student hands her phone to the supervisor, the resident or the attending or the nurse, whoever it is, judge me on how I wrote orders. Not for the week or the month, today, for that patient we just saw, right? So in the moment, judgments, and here's what then the in this case, Anna Nelson, the attending, what she is looking at. Here's the things that are part of writing orders. And then she does a 1 through 4 scale, which I'll show in more detail in just a minute. It's called the Ottawa Collectivity Scale. It's basically how much I had to do, right? How much, as a supervisor of a learner, how much I had to do. And then you can use the microphone of the phone to write one or two sentences of feedback, right? And then you say how complicated the patient was, and you literally, with your finger, sign your name, and boom, it goes into our system. So here's the scale. It's called this Ottawa Supervision Scale. I need to walk you through. So it's 1 through 4. I did it is the worst a student can do. Because I did it means the attending did it, right? Right, the clinician did it. I was available just in case is the best a student can do. Like, oh, I just hung out, right? So we can track the progress of this by asking students to get these over and over and over again, right? We're now at 8,000 data points. We're crowdsourcing in the moment demonstration of skills across our students. So here's two of the curves. The top one is EPA 4. That's again the writing orders. The bottom one is EPA 5, which is writing notes. All right, writing notes on the chart. And you could see that they started. I'm going to go over here. That this student here started at a 2, right? That means I had to walk them through it. And then you could see that they went up a little bit, they bounced around, but look at this. Now over time, they're 4s. The same as here, this is for this other one, right? So you can see over time that they have, now you're getting in the moment judgments about how they're doing. So all of a sudden, we have crowdsourced a learner assessment across in real clinical situations about work that actually matters to physicians. That's very, very different than what we've been doing in the past. Very, very different, right? That's the concept here, right? And we're not talking about, 6 grades for clerkships. We're talking now, each student is gonna have, probably on the order of about 500 judgments, right, around these skills that matter to being a clinician. That's where this is going. So what you're seeing here on the top is the variance of which skills the student is actually picking. And so what you see here is that the students are picking certain things but not other things, which also tells us something about the curriculum as well as what they're learning. And then the bottom tells us something also that's interesting, which is this. They don't choose attendings very frequently. They choose nurses more, right? And they choose residents more, which is another interesting part. So who's making the judgments? Because the students still fear that they don't want to piss off the attending, like quit irritating me with this thing, right? And they also don't want to, quote, mess with my grade because they're still getting grades at the end, right? And so we have to sort of get our head around this thing. And I should also say, I forgot to mention, because people always say, well, how much time does this take? We've done time studies, it takes 2 minutes. So if you got a student in your clinic or student on your ward, 2 minutes in an afternoon or a morning. That's on average how long it takes to click through. So crowdsourcing real-time specific skills, that's the concept. And so you can actually show how a student is doing. So this is, again, one of our students. The student, right, is the bar. The class average is the green diamond. And so this student, who's actually a very good student, is ahead of their classmates and progressing towards 100% of the 13 what are called core EPAs, the 13 skills that are critical to be residency ready on day one, on July 1st of their internship year. That's the concept. So there's the crowdsourcing part, but we don't leave it just to the crowdsourcing. We also have something called an entrustment group. This is a group of highly trained people on the faculty. We also have a public member, and we have some staff members as well. And they're analogous, for those of you involved in the residency program, they're analogous to the CCCs. And what we do is we convene once a month, and we look at different students and how they're progressing. And we take all this information from all these different things, Everything from clerkship grades, peer input, sim exercises. What I was just talking about was these ad hoc entrustment decisions. That's what I was just talking about with the crowdsourcing. And we bring all this information to make a summative decision. The school is saying, we believe that we can trust you to do these things, all right? And so we give the students badges, like Girl Scouts and Boy Scouts. You can do this, right? So you can actually realize who's sick and who's not sick. You can do a patient handoff. You can actually interpret common tests. You can do an oral presentation. You can write a note. You can write an order. Not how did I do in internal medicine? How did I do in pediatrics? How did I do in psychiatry? But can you admit a patient? Interesting, right? Can you admit a patient? Can you do a procedure that is common to every specialty, right? Which is an interesting debate by itself, like what procedures matter in the modern era is a whole other part of this, right? So those are examples of what we do. And then we've done the next step, and let me tell you, this raised all hell across the country when we did this. We're the only school that has done this. We actually, after the match, we send a letter to every residency program that's accepting one of our students, right? They're coming, there's a contract. They're coming to be your resident. Oh, by the way, here's how they're doing, right? Not how shiny were they while they were interviewing, like what's their real skill set? And that's interesting, because here's on the left what's happening. People are picking residents with test scores and letters of recommendation and interviews, right? All before the match and mostly considered with a skeptical eye. Or as one person, residency program director in Texas said, I don't believe a word any medical school tells to me because you're all selling basically a bunch of poop, right? Because the schools have a conflict of interest. The schools want their students, soon to be early physicians, to get into good residency programs, so high deficiencies, right? That's a moral problem that's really, really difficult. By the way, the residency programs are the same thing for practice, right? They're gonna kick the can down the road and pass this. So how do we do this? So we're trying to get to the right side here, a portfolio, right? And that we know that we need to make improvements. And what we wanna do is this post-match handoff. If I were to say, like, George, if I had the magic wand, if I was emperor for a day, and I could say, okay, what do you really, really want to do? Here it is in a nutshell. I want somebody who says, I know where I need to get better, and I want you to help me get better. Not, oh, I'm perfect, you know, which is what a lot of people actually want to do. They want to hide their problems, not become the problem, or share their problems. So this is what it looks like. This is a competency view. We also have an EPA view. What you see here, the crosshatch lines, the crosshatch bars are where they were at the time that they interviewed. The dark blue lines, the dark blue bars, are after the match. And the yellow and the orange are the class meets. So the problem with this is really interesting because the residency program directors say, I don't know what to do with this. Like, because the schedule for internship is based upon when you want vacation, right? Not what's the best experience to overcome skills that you may not have. So it's a different kind of thing. Now here's a few concepts that are really difficult to understand in this new world, this crazy world of competency-based education that's time variable. The first thing is this whole idea of norming to a class, we gotta blow it all up. And here's the example of what I like to use, right? Let's say we were running a 100 meter dash and the standard was 10 seconds. I don't care if you're 9.9 or 9.1 seconds. The question is, can you do 100 meters? So in other words, we have to get away from comparing people to people and comparing people to standards. That's a very hard concept for people to get their heads around, right? The second thing is this, how much does it matter to be consistent? Or if someone like does a little bit worse one day, does that matter or not? Here's the hardest one, what I call the batting average problem, which in medicine we are not overt about. Right? In baseball, a 300 hitter is an all-star. What is the equivalent for taking a gallbladder out? Is it 100%? That's BS, right? Dave's in the audience. For diagnosing of an FUO correctly, what is the actual average that would say you're a competent infectious disease specialist? Good question. Right? No, we don't know this. We don't have these conversations in medicine, right? What is an all-star? It cannot be 100%. I don't believe it. So what is it? Managing hypertension, taking stones out of the bladder, whatever it is, right? Right? So we don't know. And then there's this issue of decay. So this, I told you this idea, the curves go up, we can make people get into competency, proficient, and expertise, but over time, you will decay. You will decay. So how do you boost that up? And what do you do at the learner, or for that matter, the clinician, who never gets to threshold? What do you do with them? So here's some really interesting things, this idea of entrustment. This wonderful quote from the Bible, from Luke, if you can trust people with little things, you can probably trust them with big things. So I mentioned we're trying to get this at this trust concept. So, but the focus has always been on the purple. Do you have the knowledge? Do you have the skills to be a clinician? But are you honest? Do you know when you're in trouble? Do you follow through? Right? And arguably, if you really think about who you would want as a partner, right, which one would you pick? So we're actually starting to measure the other three. Are you conscientious? Do you have discernment? And are you truthful? All right. Every clerkship at OHSU now, the core clerkships, we have people signing off on this stuff. All right. A new way of looking at things, all right, to get to things. So I told Jesse it was going to be the good, the bad, and the ugly. Here's the ugly. So this entrustment group, right? How are we doing? So this is the class of 2019. These are all doctors now, right? They're all interns across the country. The first thing is we did, an outside perspective, we did great. We had 100% match. Every one of our students found a residency program. Fantastic, right? Come to OHSU, you're gonna get a residency program. The question is, should they have gotten a residency program? That's what I'm gonna get into now, right? So 61 students finished early because they, quote, got credits. Because we're not at the point where we're gonna use the badging to allow graduation. We're getting there, but we're not there yet. So 61 students finished early, but look at this. This issue here was around the trust. So 92% of our students had no problems with discernment, conscientiousness, or truthfulness. But a few of them, there was some concerns. And one of them, there was a lot of concern. In the future, we won't let that person graduate. But the psychometrics aren't there. We don't have enough confidence in our system to say, yeah, you really are a jerk, and you shouldn't graduate, right? That's where we need to go to. But here's the part of it that's most interesting. These are just four of the EPAs, four of these skills. Right? For six, which is oral presentation, and for nine interprofessional teams, pretty good. 86% of the new docs could do orals, presentations, and 70% could work in teams. But look at orders, EPA 4, and look at deciding who's sick and who's not sick. None of them. None of them. So what does having an MD from OHSU mean? Right? This is the ugly part. We're learning information about students and soon residents and independent practice. The question is, what do we do with this information and what does it really tell us and how can we make improvements? That's where we're at. So this is the challenging part. All right. It's not all been wine and roses, resistance. So this article just got accepted in academic medicine. This is basically how radical of a curriculum do you have? And you can see OHSU is on the far right. So we've blown this up completely. Some people across the country are like, you guys rock. I got to learn more from you. I was telling Jesse, I've been asked to be a visiting professor about 40 times in the last year and a half across the country. People really want to know what we're doing here. And there's a whole bunch of other people say, you guys are crazy. I would never do that. You're actually telling people that your students are terrible? I'm like, no, I'm not saying our students are terrible. I'm just saying that our students haven't gotten the skills yet. Maybe they shouldn't be residents yet, right? That's a different thing. But here's how I feel sometimes, right? All right, so just very briefly, in about 1 minute, I'm gonna go through some of the crises we've had. The first one was that our curriculum was being debated in the Oregon legislature, right? Seriously, it's like when state senators are arguing about what we should teach medical students, that's bad news from my perspective. All right. The scientists hate this. The scientists say, you're doing MD light. You're not going to know biochemistry. You're not going to know pharmacology. This is a true story. I need 27 hours on the nephron. 27 hours. Not in the kidney, the nephron. So, like, really? That's interesting. I can barely remember the loop of Henle, you know? All right. Sorry for the nephrologist in the room. The clinicians were dismayed. And some of you actually were part of this thing. What I originally proposed was that we would not have any required clerkships. There would not be required internal medicine or surgery or psychiatry or pediatrics, because it was the skills that matter, not the specialty. Oh my God. The dean hauled my butt into his office and said, "You know the letters I'm getting from the chairs?" I'm like, "Yeah, do you like them?" He's like, "Yo, George, you're crazy," right? So that was a mess. Then everyone said, "Oh my God, George, this is gonna cost a lot of money. You're actually asking people to really like look at the students hard." I'm like, "Yeah." Like, so instead of making it cheaper, it's gonna make it more expensive. That's a big problem because our debt's high. The students, oh my God. The students revolt every minute, right? Like, this is horrible, this is terrible. You know, I'm not gonna get this. And I'm like, "Well, you matched, didn't you?" I'm like, "Well, yeah. Okay. Do you know internal medicine?" "Yeah." But let's just say they're not happy. I'll say it that way. The technology issues for that crowdsourcing are very, very difficult. Clinical placement's a big problem. Our School of Nursing is basically saying you're pushing me out of important rotations that we need as well. And then finally, and a really, really big challenge is, in the modern era, what's the compensation model if you have a learner, right? Because arguably, most of it was altruism, right? And many of you in the room have had learners with you, and you know, we're in your debt for that. Can that continue with the current production problems, or production pressures that all of us have, right? That's a really, really difficult thing. How are we gonna teach when the clinical dollars are driving everything is a very, very big problem. Well, this is a very famous painting, and I gotta tell you a very quick story. So Cortez was a conquistador who conquered Mexico. What people don't know is when he landed at Veracruz, he told his crew, his soldiers, "We're not going back to Cuba. We're either gonna die trying, or we're gonna conquer the Aztecs." And he burned the ships. Right? So when people say, like, "George, when are you gonna stop messing with this stuff, right, and go back to what it used to be?" I'm like, no, the ships have been burned, right? So we've actually done this whole thing about how to do change management. I won't go through the whole thing, but you actually can figure out a way to actually change an organization, and that's actually an interesting skill. We're trying to actually teach the students this. How do you change a system? All of us have done end-arounds. All of us have problems with the systems we work in, every one of us, right? Can we make the system better? How do we do that? That's part of what we're trying to teach. The other thing is this. People say, like, "We're tired of change. When are you going to stop?" I'm like, "Oh, no. This is like water skiing behind a tomcat," right? Right? There's more change coming. And actually, Providence is part of this. So Jesse mentioned that we're with UC Davis, we received a $1.8 million grant from the AMA on changing residency. And we have this thing called COMPADRE, the California-Oregon Medical Partnership to address disparities in rural education and health. It's also urban underserved as well. And here's the thing we're going to do. Early differentiation. We're going to ask students, before they start medical school, what specialty do you want to be? Early tracking, even earlier, right? We're going to embed them into residency programs across between Sacramento and Portland, including here as an example. Off cycle, and that means whenever you're done, you become a resident, right? It could be November, it could be October, it could be April. And we're gonna teach you better skills, we're gonna have community mentors, and we're gonna actually measure outcome. Are people actually serving, practicing with under-resourced populations? We're gonna change literally the face of medicine. On the upper left is Eric Brode, and he has a program called Y East. We have more Native American students at OHSU than any other medical school in the country now because of Eric's program, all right? And the one on the right is from UC Davis with primarily Hispanics and African Americans. On the left, bottom left, is a bunch of the residency program directors that are part of this. 31 residency programs are part of COMPADRE, 10 different healthcare systems, including Providence. Finally, the lessons learned, and then I'll stop. There's a bunch of things that we learned, everything from don't let the perfect be the enemy of the good, you know, pick people wisely. The most important one is number 6, tolerate risk. I'll say it a little bit differently. The reason that we've been able to do what we've been able to do at Oregon, at OHSU, has been the following. We knew we would fall down. We weren't afraid to fall down. What matters is getting up, right? So we're going to continue doing this. We believe that we can influence the national conversation around this. And we don't believe that time should be the metric of when you learn. This is not tea. You know, put the tea bag in, seep it for a minute, and you're done. This is not tea, right? This is far different. Let's not produce doctors that aren't skilled enough to be doctors, right? And we'll do it at whatever time it takes to do that. That's what matters. So with that, thanks for listening to me, and hopefully I've irritated a bunch of you, and hopefully at least raised some provocative thoughts in your heads about how you're going to do all this stuff. So thanks so much for having me. Do we need these mics or not? Go ahead.
You indicated that there are many people trying to tell you how to teach medical students.
Yes. Every day.
Right. Many people outside of medicine, to me that seems like, to me, like the tail wagging the dog. What do you do about teaching medical students about leadership, number one? And number two, business management is very important in medicine nowadays. Yep. What do you do to add those skills to medical students?
That's actually part of health system science. So everything from how to be a leader, and what's interesting about leadership is you also need to know what's called followership, right? So everyone can be a leader, but everyone else needs to know how to follow, right? So that's everything from being an advocate to different leadership models that we're teaching students along those lines. The business piece is more difficult. Primarily, we're dealing with doing that with things like value, cost-conscious care, the cost of drugs, for example. When you're talking to a patient about options, do you talk about what's it going to cost you versus the system versus the insurer, right? Those kinds of things. That's part of the conversations we're having. So we're embedding some of this, but I would say we're probably toddlers in the journey. But we're doing that. In terms of the part about the tail wagging the dog, so I'm gonna come at it from a couple different ways. We're not abdicating the importance of the profession determining what's important for the profession. What we're doing is we're also including other voices, right? And so where's the patient voice, for example, in all of this is an interesting thing to think about. So to me, it's not a instead. It's also in addition to, and that's maybe the nuance that I think is important.
Also quickly, since you are preparing medical students in deciding their specialty a priori, how would you deal with those that change their mind?
Okay, so I'll do that while I'm, here you go. So let me answer the second question real quick. There's off-ramps and on-ramps is the short version. So in other words, if someone decides, you know what, I thought I was gonna be a family doc, I hate it, I'm gonna go be a surgeon. They can do that. If someone wants to be a surgeon, they wanna be a whatever, orthopod instead of a general surgeon, they can do that. So you have to allow flexibility. So I didn't go into this, but in that PACE diagram, there's a drop dead date for the residency program that's much earlier than a drop dead date for the student. The student decides after the residency program, right? They can bail out. This has been actually pioneered at Columbia and at Minnesota where they've done this. And it's about an 80% stickiness. So about 20% of students will change their mind. So you have to allow flexibility, but we think we're allowing fast tracking, which will save time. And I want to just say this, but I didn't go into the metrics of this. We've been able to, the average student debt at OHSU in 2014, right, was $217,000. Because early graduation and a bunch of other things we've done, we were able to drop that by $15,500 on average, right? So early graduation is also a cost-saving piece, is another part of this. Anyway, go ahead.
So my question was about, you showed the nice chart about the different universities and the redesign in OHSU on the far right, demonstrating you guys are kind of the radical group there. Mm-hmm. My question is, how are you going to validate that approach that you guys are using in order to convince the rest of the universities that this approach makes sense?
It's a great, great question. The answer is we have a whole bunch of metrics we're looking at. I can go into this in spades, but it's everything from where they practice and what their clinical outcomes are to have they match, they get a license, are there issues in residency program. There's a lot of pieces to this. Debt is one of them. The competency skill sets across with observers that are neutral. There's a lot of pieces I didn't go into about the evaluative component of this. It has to be evidence-based. Just like there's evidence-based medicine, there has to be evidence-based education. And that's why I said we're not ready to withhold graduation yet with these systems, because they have not been validated. So what we're doing is we're basically running experiments while we hold these other things that are sort of in place. And let me be more specific. So in the clerkships, we still have tiered grading, A through F, right? While we're doing the competencies and EPAs in the background. And what's really interesting is we're actually starting to see that the skill sets in the EPAs don't necessarily match the grade they're getting in clerkship, because here's the problem. Most of the impressions that faculty make about students is based primarily on the oral presentation. And they actually don't watch people do things, right? So I'll say it a little bit differently. I was on ID consults. I just came off service at 8 o'clock this morning, in fact. So I had a student resident fellow with me all week. And did I watch my student do an examination? Did I watch my student take a history? No. I listened to the student's presentations, and I read their notes in the chart. And I'm making judgments about clinical skills based upon those two data points. That's the flaw in our system right now. We need to get better. So there's a whole series of evaluations that are part of this thing. We think that we're going to have the data to prove the point, but we're not there yet. But you're right. Nobody should take this on until the data is firm. Dave.
George, the innovation is tremendous, and I enjoy the presentation each time. It gets more and more sophisticated. Question in how are we going to know what we're missing? We fast track. What opportunities are we missing? And now that you've got graduates that have been through the system and are out there performing, I'm sure you've already thought of this. How are we going to get feedback from them, not only on the stickiness issue, did I make the wrong choice, but on the granularity issue? What basic science, for example, should you have taught me that you didn't teach me?
Yeah, it's an excellent question and a fair criticism. Let me briefly, it's a link to the prior question about the evaluation. So we've graduated two classes now, class of 18, class of 19, that are in their residency programs. And what we've gotten both from the learners, in other words, in their internship year, were you prepared, right? We've gotten that, and our numbers are better than they used to be, right? Not great, not 100%, but like on a scale of 5, it's like 4.7, 4.8 versus what used to be 4.3s. More importantly, from the program directors, we're hearing much better comments around, oh my gosh, these students were really much better prepared to be interns, et cetera. But we have to get even further out, and Compadre is part of this. We're actually going to, without going into all this crazy details, here's the short version. Mark Trill at NYU has been able to use the master file for physicians in the country to track not only where people go into practice, but then using, and I know that the data has all sorts of issues, but hospital compare and physician compare to start looking at clinical outcomes. That is the gold standard, is are they better clinicians with regards to quality of care? Now, so that's, I think we'll get there in terms of the proving one way or the other whether it works. Your other question, I think, is to me is in many ways more disturbing. What are we missing, right? We've already picked up some of those by those curricular holes. There's things we know that we, as a profession, we think these are really important things, and no one's looking, right? So we're adjusting the curriculum to fill those holes. We're also having some very difficult conversations around what does it mean to be a doctor right now? In other words, and actually, I'm going to use an example from our specialty. And that is, believe it or not, the skills of a microscope, right? So when I was a student, a resident, a fellow, an early clinician in my career, I mean, I would look at the microscope all the time, right? And whether it was pap smear or looking for, you know, trich in a pelvic exam, or looking at a Gram stain myself, right, from sputum, right? You can't find a microscope in a clinic or a hospital by and large.
You can hardly find a lab.
That's right. That's exactly right. So it brings up all sorts of questions around what actually are the skills that actually matter. I don't think we know. I really don't think we know, right? I'm if anything keeps me up at night, it's this. What are we missing? And how do we know? You know, there's that old adage, a fish doesn't know they're swimming in water. The fallacy is we've been swimming in water and we didn't know it. that's the thing. Maybe one more question, then we'll call it a day. Yeah.
One of the most important things I think of my medical education was mentorship.
Yeah.
And that includes mentorship as a medical student, getting to know interns,
yeah,
residents, and the fine faculty, and those people still stick with me.
Yeah.
It's subjective. You can't put it to the test you're doing there.
Yeah. Yes and no.
It's a different person.
Yeah.
Every experience is different for every student.
Agreed. Agreed. It brings up this whole issue around coaching and stuff like that. So mentors are absolutely critically important. There's no doubt about that. We've been pioneers in the coaching and our coaching models across the country. Many schools have actually emulated what we've been doing. And it costs a lot of money. It's hard money that's going into the coaching of students. But here's the issue, though. The question is, what are the similarities and the dissimilarities between a coach and a mentor? And we're starting to tease some of that out, because mentors, by and large, are not assigned. They sort of are, they spontaneously form mentor-protege relationships. So what is it about that, and what can we learn about mentoring that's important in the educational trajectory and pathway? So I think I'm agreeing with you that that's a hole that we have to think about and fill in. The coaches are part of that, but it's not the whole thing. I'd love to get your thoughts more about, like, how would we do that and how would we capture that? Because you're right, it's invisible right now.
Many of our professors were in private practice,
yep,
outside the medical school,
yep,
and they were paying back.
Correct.
Teaching,
yeah.
And teaching you how to think.
Exactly. That's exactly right, and that's why with the compadre, we think
they don't cost anything.
Well,
they do it for free.
You'd be surprised. More. More, yeah, more and more now. It's not a criticism, it's a factual statement. The OHSU pays out to all the healthcare systems, including Providence, $1.9 million per year to take our students. So this idea of community altruism, it's getting harder to find it.
Are you projecting for the future? Because of this whole... Yeah. The whole financial and the systems are evolving and changing, and not for this quality mentorship.
You're absolutely right about that. So I know people, it's over time. Yeah. So here's my final comment. It's going to be an outrageous comment, just because you're absolutely right. But here's the thing. Back in the medieval times, knowledge was a sacred thing. It was housed primarily in two places. Courts, royal courts, because that's where the books were, the royal libraries, right, and monasteries or convents, right? That's where the knowledge lived, that's where the books were, before public libraries. Nowadays, everything is here. Well, a lot of things are here. Not mentoring, but a lot of the knowledge stuff is here. And so, I don't know if you've heard of Coursera. It's a very interesting company, but here's the model is going to change, how they're saying the model is going to change. Knowledge actually is not the commodity that's going to be paid for in education. It's testing that will be paid for. So the knowledge will be free. The mentoring might be free, but the testing is what's going to matter. That's what's going to make the degree. And so medical schools of the future might literally be testing centers, not teaching centers. That's a controversial statement. Thanks. Yeah. Isn't it fascinating?
Keep the ferment going, George. Keep fighting the battle.
Great seeing you.
Good seeing you.
Things are good.